Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome at my session, AI on the Microsoft Stack. And this 45 minutes, we're going to talk about AI, and then especially with AI on the Microsoft Stack. So my name is Henk Boelman, and I work as a cloud solution architect for a company in the Netherlands called Heroes. I'm a Microsoft MVP, and I run several user groups in the Netherlands. So in my daily life, I'm a cloud solution architect, where I try to implement AI projects in bigger solutions. So I want to start off with like a quick thing, what AI is and what AI is absolutely not. First of all, this is nothing new. The concepts are there and go back to the 90s. It is mostly used as an umbrella term for like lots and lots of math and sciencey stuff. But over the last 5 to 10 years, it got a huge boost with the rise of the cloud. This thing, Azure, came to life, so then Microsoft started investing more in AI. So a big question we're all having, is AI our friend? Or is AI our enemy? So let's first start with what AI cannot do. It can, at the moment, not replace a thinking creative human. It cannot magically make up gaps in your data, yet lots of tools tell you that they can, but that is not true. It cannot learn in any creative way like we humans can do, and they absolutely don't have any morals or ethics. So what can it do? So we first have to ask ourselves the question, what is machine learning anyway? And machine learning is that machines have the ability to learn from experiences without being explicitly programmed for that. So when I started programming, I did a lot of if-then-else statements, like whiles and then, so I made a bunch of instructions for my machine. And now with machine learning, I can give it like a bunch of examples and answer and let the machine figure it out by itself. So that sounds really awesome to me. So AI can answer questions for us, but it is quite important to ask a good question. And I will come back later on what these questions can be. So AI is as intelligent and as good as we developers or data scientists or people who apply it, because we give it the examples. So how can it help us? It can help us with automation to replace the boring tasks where we humans are not made to do for, because after 6 hours of doing something, we just fall asleep. We need to have change. So AI is very good in that. AI is also good in error preventing, just looking at things and do some preventing on the errors. It can do predictions, and it is good in analyzing massive amounts of data where we don't even have time to go all through. And one of my favorite things is that it can be helpful in creating new, smart, and intelligent interfaces, because I'm quite bored of typing on my keyboard. So let's have a look at the Microsoft AI platform. It is quite big, and it covers like the whole spectrum of AI at the moment. So we start off with some pre-trained models. So there is custom vision, there is speech, there is language, and these are models trained and maintained by Microsoft, and you can consume them through APIs, same as with any other cloud provider. It supports most of the deep learning frameworks like TensorFlow, ONNX, Keras, PyTorch. It has some productivity services, which we're going to zoom in a bit later, like Azure Machine Learning Services and Azure Machine Learning Studio. It has a lot of AI machines, very expensive machines you can just spin up when you need it, when you need to train your models. You spin up like a huge batch cluster and it will just train your model for you. And it can help you in deploying it, like for instance to Raspberry Pis on the edge or your local machines, or on-premise, or of course, if you want to host it, you can also host it with Microsoft in the cloud. So first, let's zoom into the Microsoft Cognitive Services. And like I said already, Microsoft Cognitive Services are pre-trained and maintained models from Microsoft, put in the cloud available through APIs. They're all free to try out. You don't need any accounts or anything. You can do like a few thousand requests. And afterwards, you have to pay like 1 cent for every 1,000 requests. So these cognitive services are divided in roughly 4 areas. So vision, speech, language, and knowledge. Where vision is the services that make your application see. Speech, for making your application talk and listen to you. Language, for understanding what is being spoken. And knowledge, if you find it a good idea to hook your website up to the Bing search engine. So the first is the Face API. And the Face API is quite a cool API. It can do a lot of things. It can detect people in the API, tell you where those people are, tell you funny facts like age, or if someone is wearing glasses. But it can also be used to identify people. So you can train it, give it your own images, and train it to recognize people. So Uber is a company that is actually using the service in their app. So I'm going to show you like a very small video about how they are applying this AI thing.
We come to work every day to pilot, test, and launch new technology solutions. Real-time ID check is the latest technology example where we at Uber are constantly developing and testing new solutions to predict, prevent, and reduce security risks in ways that weren't possible before. It's through this partnership with Microsoft that we've been able to develop this technology quickly and ensure that every rider and every driver has an excellent experience. Real-time ID check is a prompt that appears in the driver's app, asking them to take a self photo. We can do a check in real time to make sure that that identity of the person who took the picture matches the account holder who's been approved to drive. Doing that serves a couple of purposes. Drivers know that their identities and their accounts are being protected, and riders know that the driver who they're with has been screened.
Jen?
Evan?
Yeah. Hi.
Real-time ID is a smart technology. What that means is it factors in and addresses the edge cases. The situation where the driver is wearing glasses or a hat and they weren't in the identification that we have on file. The beautiful thing is it can recognize these changes and ask the driver to remove their sunglasses or retake the photo. The partnership with Microsoft Cognitive Services allowed us to go from idea to execution to implementation across the country in a matter of months. Already, we've been able to make thousands of rides safer, and very soon we're going to be making millions of rides safer through this technology.
So this is one of the things you can actually do and is running in production now with this Face API. So first I want to have a look at natural language processing. And that is at the moment very popular for like chatbots. Like we have the Amazon Echo, we have Cortana, but we also see like a lot of chat interfaces for service desks. So Microsoft has one offering that is called Language Understanding Service. And that is an API where you send a sentence to, like a question or something like a sentence. Do I have any comments? And you can train it to extract an intent from that sentence. And the cool thing is that you can ask the sentence in multiple ways and it maps it to a single intent. So in your code, you can just build like a switch statement on that single intent. So if you can go further, you can also put entities in the sentence. Like, are there any negative comments or any positive comments? So then this API will return the JSON you see there with the intent comment, and it will tell you the entity of type sentiment is negative. There is computer vision. It can tell and describe what is on images. A man flying through the air while riding a skateboard is what it will tell you when you upload this picture to it. It can also read handwriting, and it can read type text, OCR. Then there is like the custom vision service. That is a specialization which you can use to train your own image classifiers. So you upload a bunch of images to this custom vision servers, you hit the train button, and then you can send an image to the cloud and it will just recognize what is on the image. And that just can be done by uploading roughly 50 images of one thing you want to have recognized. And one other cool thing about the custom vision service is that you can export that model and actually run it on your local devices, like a mobile phone or a Raspberry Pi or on your Windows machine. Then there is a section speech conversation. There is a text-to-speech service where you can stream audio to. There is speech-to-text. There is a speaker recognition service that you can actually use in your applications to identify individual speakers. And there is real-time speech translation. So you can start speaking in 10 different languages and it can be translated to 52 languages, including Klingon. Then there is sentiment analysis. You can extract some emotions from some people, but you can also do text analytics. So it can tell you about the sentence, what the sentiment is, if it is a negative or a positive sentiment. So if you're building like a comment system on your website, you can already pre-check if some people are not putting negative comments on your website. A little bit further, there is the content moderator, and that goes a bit further than just looking at sentences. So imagine you have your website, lots of user-generated content comes in, like with text and with images. And then also negative things come in, and you as a developer sit at your desk and you're moderating it yourself, but it becomes too big. But you still don't have money to hire a bunch of these guys to do the moderation for you. So then you can put the Microsoft Content Moderator service in between. And that one can do image moderation, text moderation, and video moderation for you. It just does image moderation and it reads the text that is on the image for you. So if people hide text in images, it will scan it for you. It can classify if the image is racy or adult content, so you can skip all the porn from your website. And it can detect faces in the image. And it also automatically detects if these faces are celebrities. So if someone uploads this to your website, you can prevent it from happening. So then there is the Anomaly Finder, another offering that can help you find anomalies in big sets of data. So you send a bunch of data in time intervals to this service, it's a JSON file, and you get back like expected values, the lower and the upper margin wherein it is still correct, the data, if the data point is an anomaly, and if it is a dip or a spike. And you can make cool graphs from it, and this is like a graph from temperature data, so then it will filter out which data points are not good, just out of the box without you having to train the model. So let's dive in a little bit deeper. These services are all out of the box, and you don't have to do much to configure it. But with Azure Machine Learning Studio, you can bring your own data and start training it. So before you bring the data, you have to go like through 6 steps. You have to ask a sharp question. So you need to have a question. You need enough and good data. Then you have to shape data, select the appropriate algorithm, train your model, and after that, actually use it, because I see a lot of projects actually not being used. So first, ask a sharp question. So what is a sharp question? It is how much or how many? Is it this or is it that? Is it that cat or is it a dog? Is this weird, what we saw with anomaly detection? To which group does it belong to? Or which action should I take now? So these are like 5 questions you can actually ask. So my question for this demo, this talk, is what is the price of a second-hand car? And I wanted to know that because I was building a website where I wanted to predict the price of a second-hand car when people uploaded and start selling second-hand cars. So I needed data. And there are really lots of websites that actually provide this data for you. So there is Kaggle, where you can download huge data sets. There is UCU, like that has a lot of government data sets available. And also Azure Machine Learning Studio has some sample data sets for you, where you can play around with. So to clean up the data, I use Azure Machine Learning Workbench that can go over huge data sets, and that can just format the data set also for me a little bit and do some things. And it can read in more lines than Excel or something else can handle. So then I had to prepare the data. So I had to ask myself for every column in the data set if it was relevant, independent, simple, or clean. So what is relevant data? So in this data set, I don't need to train my model with an ID field. Or maybe the city was not so relevant for the general price of a car, and especially a VIN number, I didn't even know what it was. It had to be independent. So I didn't need like two columns actually telling me the same thing, like year and age. It's basically the same thing. So if I would use this data to train, the year of the car would count double, probably. It had to be simple enough. So instead of all these different type of models, I factored it down to like telling like the main model and not like if it is like a four-wheel drive. And then I had to clean it. I had to check if there were not weird data points in it, like a 5-mile car secondhand. I just wanted to have those things out of the data set. Then I had to select an algorithm. And as I said, I am a cloud solution architect and not a data science, so I don't know which algorithm to choose. So luckily, there are cheat sheets for that. So you can look it up, follow the line, and then take like the 5 or 6 algorithms that are capable of maybe solving your problem. And the cool thing about the Machine Learning Studio is that you can run these algorithms next to each other and compare the outcome and then select the best algorithm for your problem. So then the fun part starts, training the model. So and this is how like a small process of training a model will look like. So you import your data, your clean data. You still do some pre-processing to tell like, hey, this is a category, or this is an integer, this is a string. Then you split the data like 70% or 80% for training and 20% for validating your results. Select the algorithm, train it, score it, and then evaluate your model to see which one is the best. So in Azure Machine Learning, it looks like this. It is just a drag and drop interface. You can just drag those states on and hit the train button, and Azure will handle all the training for you on the background. It will spin up some machines and you don't have to worry about that. And then eventually when that thing runs, you get those two numbers, and that is where you've all done it for. And the highest is the best, I found out. And the top one is the left one, and the other one is the right one. So then you shape your thing together, you remove the algorithms you're not going to use, hit train again, that will take like 1 minute, and then you can start using the answer in your solutions. And out of the box, you get an API, a scalable API, where the machine learning model is hosted. And you get some like test fields where you can actually submit fields to your model to evaluate. And you get some cool insights about how your API is being used. And then you can use the API, like for in this case, I was making an Umbraco website, to use the API on a safe action to actually predict the price of the second-hand car. So Machine Learning Studio is quite easy and quite cool to use. And there are a lot of examples that you can just click and it will build this environment for you. And you can look at in the individual steps to see how it works and then start using your own data. So like you saw, I downloaded a data set with past data. So all this machine learning stuff you do looks at past data. So if I'm going to make like a hiring system for, let's say, new people to my company, and my company at the moment only work people with long beards and mustaches, machine learning will not suggest any time that a female or anyone with short hair will work at my company. It will always look at past experiences. So then if you want to go a little bit further and not do drag and drop things, there is Azure Machine Learning Services, and it is only 2 weeks old. So it is just there, it's just been announced by Microsoft. And that is a fully managed cloud service that enables you to build, deploy, and also have some insights and history about how your models have been trained. So with this machine learning studio, you don't see what happened to come to this model. And in a lot of other environments, I see people just running things on their local machine in some notebooks, and there is no backtrack of history or things like developers do, like git commits or version management. So Azure Machine Learning Service helps you with that process. So to get started, you have to create a workspace. When you have a workspace, you can start training your model, and then you can deploy your model and actually manage it in like a Kubernetes cluster. So when you start, you have to create your team workspace. And in your team workspace, everything happens. Your computers there, like batch AI clusters to train the model. The experiment describes what you're going to do. It stores the files you used for your training of the model. It has data stores that can hold the data you're using for that specific training round. So everything is there. And there is model management. The models are converted later on to Docker containers. So there is a Docker registry, there container registry. And then afterwards it can deploy it for you to a Kubernetes cluster or to Azure container instances. And this you can use in three different ways. So you can use Visual Studio Code, install tools for AI in it. You can use Jupyter Notebooks, just running on your own machine. Or you can use Azure Notebooks, that are Jupyter Notebooks in the cloud for Azure, and install the Azure Machine Learning SDK for Python. Or you can use the Azure portal to just click and drag and drop. So let me show you a little bit of code of how you can use that. So here I have an Azure notebook, and this we're going to use to train like a model that can recognize digits. So I'm using an MNIST database thing algorithm for that. So the first step is to load all the dependencies, and you see here I load an Azure Machine Learning dependency. And if you use Azure Notebooks, it is all pre-installed. If you do it yourself, you have to pip install everything. So we start running that. And here it gives us the version. So we can create a workspace like this in code. We can do it here in the Azure portal by, this is actually a workspace, by creating a new workspace, like here. Create new resource, or you can do it in Visual Studio Code, and then you can just right click and say create workspace. And underwater it is all connected to your Azure. When you first do that, it will just show you a screen, you have to put in a code, and it will just arrange the connection for you. So we create a workspace. The workspace is already created. So I load the workspace in this variable, and I ask, hey, give me the details from this workspace. So it will tell me where my workspace is and how I can access it and how it is connected. I can ask it, hey, give me all the experiments that are currently on there. So you see I have Hank and Hank and Hank in my first demo. It can also give you a list of all your compute targets. So I have two clusters running, and that are two batch AI clusters with only one node. But there are some GPU machines with 65, 50, 6 GB of RAM. Because it is Python, I can list through it. And here I can select the cluster I'm going to need for this demo. You see I've already, the cluster can be spun up on demand, or you can just have always one node standby. It depends on how much money you want to spend on the cluster. These machines cost around €900 a month. So I would suggest that you let Azure handle when they have to come up and when they have to come down. But for this demo, I didn't want to wait for the machine to start up because it takes like 5 to 10 minutes. So I have one node idle waiting for us. And then we can start loading the data set. It will download it from these resources. And then we can get some samples out of it when it is done downloading. It's not too fast today. Yes, it is there. So now it will take around 30 random images from this data set and it will show it in a second. And then when we have the data set, we can, with this comment, we get our like default data store and we can push all the images we have downloaded and all our training data straight up to Blob Storage versioned in the cloud. So we will also run that. And we will wait a little bit for this. Yes. So here we see the data set we're going to use with the corresponding labels. So then it is time to create your experiment in your workspace. So that has been done. I will call it like Hank 001. It is already there. And then I start copying my the files I use for the training of the model to the workspace. So now it is copied. And here I execute the command for the actual training. And then it is going to run. And the training will take, I think, about like 2 minutes. So when this is done, and this run is done, we can ask for like a graph that will show us the status of the training process. So we'll see that back later when it is done, hopefully. So Azure Machine Learning Workspace does a few things for you. That were a bunch of comments I just showed. So first of all, it will send a snapshot of all my data and all my things to the experiment in the cloud. After that, it will create for me a Docker image. It will deploy the Docker image to my compute target. It will mount my data store to this compute target. It will launch the script for the training and will start training. And then it will stream out the logs back to my local computer or my Azure notebook. And then it will copy out over the output of the training, the models, back to my experiment where I can actually promote them to real models I want to use. So if we look a bit further, we have the preparation part, we have the experiment part, and then when we have registered our model, what we're going to do next, we can build like a proper Docker image, which you can download and run on your local machine, do whatever you want with it. But it can also deploy it automatically to an Azure Kubernetes service. So that is an Azure managed Kubernetes environment, or to Azure Container Instances, which you can create on the fly. So let's hope this model is trained now. Yes, it is still training. But here you see the outputs being streamed back from the batch cluster that is actually training it and shows us nice graphs and some other insights. And here it will show us the validation and the training accuracy. And it is updated real time. So it is quite cool to have that real time insights from Azure, but still in a Jupyter notebook. So luckily I've already trained a model. and the run is complete. Perfect. So here we can run like a small, some other graphs over the model. I have to say these Python things are sometimes quite slow. So we can create some other things. So now we have our trained model and we want to register it so we can use it to deploy it with in the container. So we can use this comment to create a version of our model. And this is like, I think, the fourth or fifth time I've trained it, maybe third. Yes, actually third. So here it will tell us that it's the third version of the model. We can also see that back in the Azure portal. If you go to models, you see all your different models. You see here that we have just pushed the third version of it. So then we can create an image for the model that can take pretty long, like 5 minutes. So we're not going to wait for that. Sorry. We first have to create a score.py, what actually will do the scoring for us against the model and what is being called from the API. You have to add a environment variable, what the Docker image has to install. And then you can create your container image. So this image will now create. And hopefully it is done. So like I said, for creating an image, you have to have a scoring file and you have to define your Python environment. It will wrap it up in an image and then it can deploy those images to AKS or Azure container instances for you. So the image is still being created. So this is the code here that you need to deploy it to an Azure Kubernetes instance. So you just create the instance by saying, I want 2 CPU cores, I want this amount of money, memory, and it will create it for you. But you have to have your image running. And then you can start testing the service. So I have already the another service up and running. So we ask for a list of services that are actually running at the moment. And if the list comes, we can use like the name of the model and run some tests on it. And I know that for a fact that this one is running. I also start that. So hopefully it will come back. And then eventually what we get, if that model is running, we get like a scoring URL, which you can see here in your deployments. So I have 2 deployments at the moment. So I click on 1 deployment and I find like a scoring URL here. So I can copy that scoring URL, go to like this program I've made, paste it in here, and try to draw like a figure, like a tree, click a recognize button, and it has now compressed that image to 28 by 28 pixels, send it to the cloud, and gave back that it was this result. And this is like the local model that is running locally on the computer to compare how they were. So this is still doing not much. It's probably waiting for this service to create. So I'll continue with this. So we've seen that Azure Machine Learning Services does like the whole progress and really simplifies the data science progress for us, because it will leave a trail of what all your data scientists and your whole team have been doing. So so I want to close off with like a few statements about machine learning. So machine learning is all about returning assumptions. And it necessarily is not necessary that we get truth from algorithms. And limited data, I've seen it a lot, especially with face recognition, leads to very weird and very weird results. So AI can ask questions, can answer questions, but you have to ask a good question. So lots of companies come to us and ask, we need AI. Can you implement it? And then always my question is, what is your question? What do you want to have solved? Which problem? And they mostly don't know. But I think AI can be of amazing help in lots and lots of different environments. So thank you. And if anyone have questions, this is the time. Good questions, yes. I think that is it for today. Thank you, and enjoy the last few hours of the conference.